My name is Chinan Marx, and I'm going to be talking about practical type erasure. And emphasis will be on the word practical. And so forgive me, I'm going to stand here with my butt to you. One of the interesting things about coming here is that I go home and I always go home with a butt. I can't do this with my butt to you. One of the things I do is I come home and I learn all these great new techniques and I want to use them in my code. And oftentimes either I can't, it's too hard, it's not useful, stuff like that. I want to be able to use these things, and not just to impress my friends, you know, but to actually use it in real working code. So that if you were in Louis's talk just now, when he asked, what is C++ template metaprogramming? And one of the big answers was, well, show off to your friends, you know, do neat tricks, stuff like that. But I'm an engineer, and I want write real code that runs on real machines and for real people. And so I want to use these tricks in real life, and that's an important thing for me. So first of all, this talk will not be in the cutting edge at all. On the contrary, type erasure has been around for a long time, and we'll talk about that. So however, this code that I'm going to show you is real production code. And before anybody gets too worried, I developed this code for the US federal government. There is no copyright, it's in the public domain. So I'm free to come here and talk about it and show it to you. The other thing is I did change the names to make them simpler because there was a lot of domain specific stuff, which makes it less interesting. And then finally, I'm gonna say all of the code is in GitHub and the address over there. I tagged it with CPP Now 2014. The reason being is that I turned the library into a headers only library. In practice, that's a lousy idea. And I'm going to turn it back into a non-header library. But in order to compile and run the examples that I'm going to show, it's a lot easier to compile and run them as a header-only library. And so that was the point, basically, to make it easy to use. So all of the code that you're seeing today actually runs. Okay. So.
Which compiler or what do you require?
So this code was originally written, well, let me talk about that in the next slide, okay? That's something I'm going to address. So let me take a quick poll. Who here has used type erasure beyond just checking it out? Actually use it to accomplish something in working code. Right, and of course, so boost function is certainly counts as that. Who here knows how type erasure works, the internals? So about half, all right, so please forgive me, I'm going to spend about two slides on how it works and the internally, and that will be a repeat for you, for the half that didn't know this. And then boost any, so let's talk about what I'm going to talk about. I'll explain what is type erasure and give a quick example, a bare bones example, okay? I will talk about boost any, which is a specific usage of type erasure. And then I'm going to talk about practical type erasure for the rest of the talk, where I'm going to show how I use boost any in a configuration system that we built for the government that, I'll talk about the requirements later, okay? So before I continue with my talk, however, I have to make a note. In the abstract for the talk, I said this worked in C++ 03. That's actually not true anymore. When I was putting the talk together, like I said, I changed some of the names and I upgraded some of the code, and I couldn't be bothered with one of the iterators. I just put an auto in there, and then I was writing a for loop, and I just used range for. But nothing here is going to be C++ 11 heavy. If you really, really needed to run this on a C++ 98, you can undo the range for, and you can figure out what that iterator has to be, and it will work. And this code did work in C++ 98. I wrote this in 2008, and in the government, they're conservative, so we were using old compilers. It was a mess. I had to be back compatible with Solaris, believe it or not. This code is really going to be back compatible. And so I know for sure it ran on GCC 4.4, but all of the examples I'm using today were tested on GCC 4.8. They work, okay? So that is where I lied. There are no statistics in the talk. Okay, so let's talk about type erasure. What is type erasure? Well, I learned about this a little late, I admit, from Scott Myers' article in Artema for about his top aha C++ moments. And this was one of those things I was reading one day when I had a little time, and he talks about things that made him just stop and say, oh, you know, that's pretty cool. And I'm thinking, at that time, I'm a pretty sophisticated C++ programmer. I was not impressed. The first three, you know, I don't even remember what they were, but I was like, oh, I knew that. But then the fourth one was type erasure, and it blew my mind because he explains what I'm about to explain, and he used a specific example of the shared pointer, which was in Boost, and to me, shared pointer was Boost for the longest time. I started using Boost, I think, in the 90s, and for shared pointers, that was what it had. It had smart pointers, and what he pointed out is, in addition to the constructor that takes a regular pointer for shared pointer, and we all know what shared pointer does, I hope, there's the constructor, another constructor that takes the deleter, which will then destroy the object when the reference count of the shared pointer goes to zero. Okay, well, so far so good, big deal. But if you pay attention, what you'll notice is that shared pointer is templatized, parameterized with class T, okay, and the deleter is class D, which is a completely different class potentially. This class is introduced in the constructor for shared pointer with the deleter, but it's not in the class itself. That is, the class itself doesn't know what the deleter does, what the deleter is. Okay, how is this possible? Okay, that is the aha moment that Scott Myers pointed out in his talk, and I sat there with my jaw on the desk, trying for about an hour to figure this out. I couldn't figure it out, so I read on, and of course, as you know, the secret is type erasure. Okay, and so what I did was, I'm going to show you an example by taking type erasure down to its barest bones, okay? And the way I'm going to do that is basically throw away all of the shared pointer functionality and just you have a type, have a class that's going to get a type injected into it. It's going to invoke that injected class, and it's going to, and that's all it's going to do, okay? But notice that the type, the class C, is not parameterized. There's no template there, okay? The only template is in the constructor for C. We're going to inject a T inject, and we're going to give it an instance, okay? And then somehow we're going to store this instance in C, which again is not templatized on T inject, okay? And we're going to call invoke, and then invoke is going to deploy that instance that we stored earlier, okay, without knowing its type, all right? So here's the magic, all right? The secret for type erasure is that you have a C internal base, a base class, okay, with a virtual method, which I'm going to call doit, all right? And this virtual method does nothing, all right? Then we're going to derive from this class, and we're going to derive a templated class here that is templated on T injected, all right? And it's going to derive from C internal base, and it's going to store an instance of T injected. And so right away, you're going to see one of the limitations of type erasure, at least back in 2008, the injected class instance must be copyable, okay? Because we're making a copy right here, all right? So I understand that this is not true any longer. Oh, I'm sorry.
Don't you need a virtual destructor on internal base?
Repeat the question.
Thank you. The question was, do I need a virtual destructor on internal base? I believe the answer is no, because C internal base and C injected are private, okay? They're never, ever being used outside of my class, all right? And so the only way that I'm actually destroying them. And you know, I never thought about that, but I have complete control of the use. Okay.
Right, but you have the
Right. If you destroy it from a pointer to the base by deleting.
You're right.
Base class.
I'm going to slice.
Yeah. It would work if you had the shared pointer.
I'm sorry.
If you had the shared pointer, it would work.
Because it captures the destructor.
You're right. That's what happens when you do a quick and dirty example implementation.
That's what happens when you don't use a shell code.
You're right. You are absolutely right.
It's okay because the derived class doesn't need a specialized destructor.
The derived class has to have the destructor for T injected.
That's right, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. No, T injected would not be destroyed, and we would slice, and that's exactly the correct thing. So yes, thank you. That is a good point. All right, so don't look at what I'm doing. This is just example code.
What I mean.
Yeah. Well, use boost any, all right? It's a lot cleaner. What we're doing then is we're going to instantiate this in the constructor, which is of course templated, and so now we can instantiate a new C injected and store it in the pointer, which should be shared, of course, of our internal base. And then when we call invoke, right there, we're just going to call do it. All right? And so the do it, of course, will use standard C++ polymorphism and execute the derived class, which is going to call deploy on the injected instance. And there you have it. There is the magic sauce in type erasure, basically. By using polymorphism in this way, we hide the details from the main class, and we're able to execute the do-it method at a later time defined by the client.
So
okay.
Obviously, which I'm assuming that's a question, actually.
Please.
All of the classes that you're injecting, you're driving them from C internal base, but they all have a do it method. If they don't have a do it method, you'll invoke the default do it method.
They have the deploy method, right? So yes, that was. That's right. So that is exactly right. There is a limitation to this technique, and that is you have to agree. Oh, excuse me, I didn't repeat the question. So the question was how basically. The only thing I can do, I'm going to summarize, okay? The only thing I can do is execute deploy on the injected method, right? That's the only thing I'm doing with it and I can do it. And that's exactly correct. This is a limitation with the technique. You have to agree on the interface beforehand at compile time, okay? And so in my particular example, the only thing that I'm able to do with my injected class is called deploy, okay? And I'm going to have to And I have no choice, okay? So yes, that is a limitation of type erasure, okay?
What about if you made a copy of the class,
I am copying, you mean the instance, or?
Yeah, so I create an instance of this guy.
Which is this guy?
Sorry, you made the class C of your type that you put in there, so it's erase the type, but then you make a copy of the instance of C. Later on, a client would make an instance of C that would have this item in it, and then you can call do it on it, that's great, but when I make a copy of it, how do you copy an internal base?
Terribly. Again, example code, don't try this at home, kids. So the question was basically, what happens when I make a copy, right? And I'm violating the basic tenets of C++, which I have I'm instantiating heap objects and I'm not dealing with the copy constructor. That's absolutely correct. Again, the whole point of this is to illustrate this. If you use boost any, you don't have any of these problems. They dealt with them. If you do want to do your own, yes, that's something to deal with as well, okay? I'm just trying to keep this as simple as possible to illustrate what's going on, okay? So that is the essence of type injection, okay? So you can roll your own where you're going to agree beforehand on the interface. And so in the case of the shared pointer deleter that we saw earlier, the interface is agreed upon. The deleter is going to delete, okay? In this case, I'm going to deploy. You can also do your own where you have your own needs that you're going to call and your own interface. You can potentially pass parameters in through the constructor and store them and stuff like that. But the main point is that the interface to the injected class has to be known in advance and agreed upon. Okay, so that is a limitation. Okay, hopefully everybody now understands how type erasure works. It's not really too bad, like some of the things I've learned today. So Let's talk about boost any. Boost any is an instance of type erasure, which I just showed you before, except instead of calling a method, it's going to store a value. All right? And so here's a quick example, essentially. And I'm creating a boost any, and I'm putting a string into it. And then I'm creating a vector of strings, and I'm putting the vector of strings. I'm assigning it into it, but you can also construct it with this thing. And then I'm assigning an integer to it. And then I'm printing the integer, and in fact, this really runs. I run it, and the interesting thing is, of course, you'll note two things. One is that, again, I'll repeat, class, the object that you're putting into the boost any must be copyable because we're copying it. Now, I understand that's changing, and maybe one of the guys who's working on this can tell me. I actually tried to use boost any with a unique pointer before last week, and I failed. But
it's only movable. Unique pointer is only movable.
Exactly. Well, but boost any now does have move constructors.
Okay.
So I thought it would work. It didn't work. I'm not sure if it's boost any, if it's me, if it's my compiler. I'll investigate further. But anyway, for now, everything's copyable. And then the other thing that you need to know about boost any is, first of all, unlike the previous example, we can't invoke any methods on the stored object. We're just storing them. All we can do with it is we can get the object out again. And the way we do that is with this boost any cast, where we have to supply the type. Okay? So this brings us to another limitation of boost any. When I first saw this, I was like, aha, you know, typeless programming, Python, yay, C++. I mean, sure, C++, I appreciate what C++ types do for me, but sometimes they're a pain in the butt. And I thought, this is it. Now I don't have to worry about this anymore. I don't have to use Python. But of course, that's not true, because you're always going to have to use a cast to get the data out if you want to do anything with the data. If you just need a write-only repository when you write data and never get it again, that's great, but that's pretty useless too. Yes, please.
So in any, it's only one valid value at a time inside and not all three.
Right, that's right. So each time you, so the question was, did boost any have one valid, one value at a time? And the answer is yes. Every time that we called operator assign on the boost any, we destroyed the previous value. All right. Again, more nice details that I didn't implement in my silly example. Okay, so for the rest of the talk, I want to talk about practical type erasure. So when I read Scott Myers' article, I was like, this is so cool. I'm going to use this. You know, like I said, I want to use it like Python. I want to do all this neat stuff. And next time that the type system of C++ gets in my way, forget it. I'm just going to use boost any, and all my problems will be solved. And of course, real life is not like that. So. What I learned then was, so after I finished Scott's article, is I learned that that type erasure is not a new idea. It's been around, I think, since at least the 90s, possibly. The Boost Any article itself by Kevlin Henney, which I think is the oldest, the first article about it was published in 2000. Boost Any in documentation in Boost has a copyright of 2001 by Kevlin Henney, so whom I don't know. But it's been around for a while, okay? And some of the applications that you saw were, of course, the smart pointer deletion that Scott pointed out. And then if you Google around, and you'll find some articles that will talk about heterogeneous containers, so you can put boost anys into containers. So you can make a vector of boost anys, and element 1 can have an int, and element 2 can have a string, and element 3 can have some complex class and stuff like that, as long as it's copyable. That's great, although we'll talk about that in a bit. It's not as useful as you might think. And then Thomas Becker wrote about the Any iterator, which basically is an iterator which hides the details of the specific iterator being used. And I think Chandler Carruth referenced something like that when he was talking about his filter, if anybody was in that talk, when he was talking about filter. And part of the issues was that you had the type iterators, and he wanted to hide their values, and he considered that as one of the possibilities. So, and then finally, I must mention std function and its predecessor boost function, which also practice type erasure. And that's probably the most common way that we and I certainly have used type erasure up to this point. Okay? So I was sitting there after reading the article. I went and, of course, told all my colleagues about it, and I wrote a little thing in the company forum and got all excited. And, well, so you quickly find out that type erasure is not magic. For using boost any, somebody has to know what type to get out of there in order to do something with it, okay? Otherwise, it's essentially useless. And that means that somebody at some point must cast back to a type, okay? Now you can do polymorphism, but this is the kind of polymorphism that you were warned about, right? That your mother warned about when you were starting to learn C++, right? Where you have the big if statement. If type equals string, then do this. If type equals else, if type equals int, then do this. Else, blah, 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 right? That is an unmaintainable mess because every time you want to add a new type to this system, right? You're going to have to go and update all of your if statements, and God help you if you forget one. And that's, of course, why we have polymorphism in C++, and it's wonderful, and you should never, ever use RTTI, right, and all that good stuff. So using type erasure in real life can potentially produce ugliness, okay? And ugliness is, sometimes you can't avoid it, but at least you want to hide it. And that's one of the things I'm going to do today. So I put aside everything about boost any as yet another neat trick that I learned that I probably will never use, and moved on in life and came to a new job and saw something like this. I was tasked in creating a configuration system for a subset that was running in C++ in a larger framework, okay? And this is actually a copy of the documentation from that framework for one of the three other property systems that was existing at the same time. Now, this is the government, so things don't get deleted, okay? And so this was going to be the fourth property system in there, and basically everybody was expecting me to write something like this. You know, if you want a string, you call getString. If you want an int, you call getInt, and you want a bool, et cetera, et cetera. It's horrible. I'm thinking, this is 2008. We have templates. You know, we can do better. Okay? And this thing is a mess for many, many other reasons. So I don't think they had the term facepalm back then, but that's definitely what I was doing. Picard had already done it, but we didn't have a term for it in 2008, I think. So here I am designing a configuration framework, all right? And I sat down and I thought, what do I want in this configuration framework? I want to make this configuration framework better than what we have before, okay? And so my requirements were we needed the get and set properties. Properties are the configuration values that we're getting, okay? So not only did we want to get them, but sometimes we wanted to set them as well. Rarely, but sometimes, okay? Furthermore, we had to support multiple backends. So we were using INI files. They had their own rolled config files. We were using databases. We were using the environment. And it was this complicated scheme where the environment, we would search the environment first and look for the key there, and if it wasn't there, then you'd look in the INI file, and if it wasn't in the INI file, you could go to the database, and it was a mess. The point is, I wanted to support backends that were heterogeneous of different kinds, okay? And furthermore, I wanted to search them in different orders, et cetera, et cetera. All right? I also wanted to return more than just plain old data. If I was going to templatize my get and make it generic so that I had I don't have get string and get int. I want to get anything, you know. I mean, and then finally, I didn't want to have to force the clients to recompile every single time that I added a new type to the system or if I added a new backend to the system. Clients should only have to recompile if they use something new. An existing client would not have to recompile if, say, I added a new database to the backend, but the client's not using it, okay? These seem very reasonable things, and we all know that you can make this happen with a basic generic interface, all right? So the architecture that I came up with is that there's a front end, which is client-facing, all right? And the property system is going to use a key, a string key, to fetch all of the values. All of the values will be stored by key. The client will decide which backend to use. If the client wants the database, he can use the database. If he wants to use the environment, he can use the environment. The client decides, and the client decides in what order he's going to search them as well. Only the backends being used would be compiled, and the client would be ignorant of the implementation. Specifically, as you're going to, as I'm sure you've guessed, I'm using Boost Any to do the magic here. The client needs to remain ignorant of the fact that Boost Any is being used here. All right, I almost achieved that, but not quite. So,
probably on compile errors.
Well, yes. The reason was that I'll show it to you later. Okay. And then the backend had to be extendable. Okay, so we had a bunch of backends we were using at the time, but we wanted to be able to create new ones with time. And the backend would support specified types. So each backend knew what types it would support. That is, the environment, for example, only supported returning strings. Okay, it didn't really make sense to ask for an int from the environment. Of course, you could put JSON in your environment, but that wasn't what we were doing. Environment backend instances need to be created and destroyed, and we needed to support multiple instances. Specifically, for example, with the databases, we had 4 or 5 databases. Like I said, this wasn't simple. Okay, so there were 4 or 5 databases, and there were multiple tables in the database, and multiple queries for each table. And so I didn't want to just have one database backend. I wanted to have several database backends representing different database level, different database accesses. Okay. Can anybody tell me what would be a good architecture to implement something like that? This is not a trick question. This is a very simple question.
Because a whole bunch of people did it a whole bunch of different ways, and that's what you got.
Well, I'm not sure I understood that.
I mean, because history is. I mean, we end up with all these different things because we have to support legacy.
So the question was, what is a good way to implement this?
Oh.
I see. And the answer is PIMPL. Yeah, well, just object-oriented. You're going to make a base class for the backend, and you're going to derive it and specialize it, and each specialized class is going to implement its specific functionality. This is right basic C++ here. I'm almost embarrassed to talk about it in this conference. Okay, so right, you're just going to create instances, and I am using shared pointers now in the real code. So we have a generic front end, okay, that I discussed, and an object-oriented back end. Okay, the traditional. Now, when the generic front end has a very flexible interface, right, it can return anything. Whereas the OO backend has a very rigid interface, right? That's the main problem with inheritance type design, is that the base class specifies the interface and you're done, okay? The derived classes can't change that, okay? So how are you going to connect the two? That is the big problem. And of course, it's not going to be a surprise to you. The answer is Boost Any, all right? This is where Boost Any shines, okay? Type erasure is the glue that can connect an object-oriented, a generic interface to an object-oriented interface, okay? It's a really nice way to do this. The term I always use was where the rubber meets the road, and what I mean by that is if you've ever done any template work, you're doing stuff compiler space, and you're doing stuff in compiler space, but ultimately you have to go into runtime, and you have to somehow get between the two, and it's not clear where and when and how to do that. That's hard. And Boost Any offers the solution here, which is how this is going to work, okay? And Thomas Becker said it better than I did. He said type erasure is the glue between OO and generic programming, okay? And I suggest you read his article. It's very, very interesting. It's a bit old at this point, but it's still, I think, relevant. All right, so enough looking at my ugly slides. Let's look at some code, okay? For the rest of the talk, I will talk about how I actually implemented this property system, okay? First, let's start with the front end, okay? The front end is basically a class that will be instantiated by the client, and the class will control its handlers. The handlers are the backends, okay, or the pointers to the backends. So I've got these pointers and shared pointers now. Okay, this is real code. Not silly examples, so please yell at me if I screwed up now. Okay, although it's still a bit late for that. We have get, which is templated, and it returns whatever it is, as long as it's copyable, and takes a key, all right? We furthermore have set, which also is templated, parameterized, and you pass it a key and the value, and you're going to set that value in one of the backend handlers, okay? This is really simple. In addition, we have two more methods, public methods. We have add get handler, so we can create new backend handlers, and we can instantiate them, and we can pass them to that method. Now remember, each backend knows which types it handles, okay? So each handler will then register itself with the property system, say I can handle this type, and this type, and then will be added to a list of the handlers that will be queried when a get is made, call is made. Okay, so remember, get doesn't know in advance which backend is going to contain its data, so it has to walk down the list and query them. So, and the client has control about that list, about the order. So, right, you want to query the environment first, and then you want to query the INI file, and then you want to query the database, okay? And that's nice too for debugging, because you can then put something in the environment and it overrides the database, basically, and you don't have to go fiddle with the database, which was also a pain because we weren't allowed to touch the databases. But that's another story. So similarly, there was set handler, and set handler is different than add get handler, because while we had a list of handlers that could get data, when you're setting data, you have to tell it specifically which handler it is you actually want to set it to, right? It doesn't make sense to have a list of set handlers, because it's either going to set it or it's not going to set it, okay? So I want to point out what is not here, okay? We do not have boost any being mentioned anywhere here, all right? And we do not have types or type IDs being mentioned here, and or any sort of RTTI, and nor do we have it with the add and get handlers. The handlers, all of the ugliness, and there is ugliness here, okay, but all of the ugliness is hidden in the back end, and so that the client remains dumb and happy, okay? The client just sees this interface and all is well. I forget who asked me, but there is a small leakage here because these methods are templated. I actually had to put the implementation in the header. There was no choice back in 2008 anyway. And so the implementation uses boost any, so there's a pound include boost any in the header. Okay, so that exposes boost any to the client, but that's the limit of it. All right, yes?
So, interesting question. Well,
I hope.
No, in terms of the set handler, the template is templatized, but what? I couldn't see there's a template for T, but nothing in the argument. I figure it's copy and paste because we didn't have the semicolon at the end. So the set handler.
You're right.
Probably doesn't need to be templatized.
So the question was, why is set handler templatized? We'll take a look at the implementation in a second, but I think you're right. I don't see why it needs to be templatized.
And then the other one.
It stores the type info, I guess. So whenever you do the set handler, then it maps it.
The comment was that it stores the type info, but in fact the type info is known by the backend. Well, I'll show you how the registration works in a bit. We're not passing it explicitly.
And then another question, which is I was thinking about this because I tried to write my own thing. The get sort of implies, so type deduction could probably occur with the set just fine because you're giving it the type, so it can refer to the type. But get, you have to supply the type information, you know, the type template for there. But then you could also have written it where you give it a reference to the object and then it could do the type deduction. So you could get into something. I just was your opinion.
Right, so good question. The question was, so with set, we use template deduction, type deduction, because we pass it in as a value, and it's absolutely true. Template type deduction does work. And I have a specialization for literal strings, okay, for char pointers, which I'm not going to show you today, but because a lot of times we were looking up strings, so the specialization for char pointers allowed us to pass those in. Okay, so yes, set did give us the ability to deduce the types, but you're right, so get does not give you that ability because, let me finish, please. So, and you have to explicitly specify the type. And so the question was posed, or the comment was made basically, why not pass in a reference to the type? And so there were two reasons. One was I hate that kind of thing, okay? to me, I mean, thank God for move constructors and our values, because now everything's going back to value semantics, which I love, and I wanted to keep that. And we did use that sort of construction all over the place, and I just hated it. And it was like the RVO, the return value optimization, was around back then, and people will say, no, it's too slow. And then the second reason was it's limiting on the client. Again, the idea here is to make it nice for the client, and I hate interfaces which make the client do work, right? Because now the client has to control the lifetime of the object and everything like that. And I didn't want that. You had a question.
I'm not confident that what I'm saying is true for all types. But I actually did this, and I wanted to write a function which says has type. So before I call my get, I could say is an int, mm-hmm. right? And so what I did is I templated my setter, and then when I set the key, I also set it into an additional map, and then I used runtime type information mm-hmm. to, I didn't care what the string was, it didn't matter, but then I would, the has type, I would then was templated.
Templated. Yeah. I like that word, though.
I use runtime type information, and I could compare that key and,
right.
and detect that I wasn't going to.
So the question was, why am I not passing in the type to get and to make my life easier, basically, and to know what types I want?
Pass get. I'm talking about set.
Oh, excuse me. Well, the answer is, but set knows the type because I'm passing in the value, and the value has a type.
But that's not what I mean. When you say get, you've got to give it the value of the key.
Right.
What I wanted to do was I wanted to check to see if the templated type, if that key was really of that type. Right?
Right.
And the way I did that was I stored the type information when I did the set.
Okay.
To an auxiliary map, which was something like, standard string to runtime type
right.
information.
So the comment was basically that the type was being stored with the key, so that when get was called, you would know right away that that type was or not right. associated or not associated with that particular key. Well, I'm actually doing something very, very similar, but I didn't want to make my client have to pass in the types for get, okay, explicitly. But I am doing something like that. Let me continue and I'll show you what I'm doing. It's similar, it's not quite the same thing, but it is similar. And I didn't want to limit types, keys by type, okay? So you can have a key that goes to a string in one place, and you can have a key that goes, the same key can go to an int in a different place, okay? That's perfectly legitimate. And depending on which one you specify you want is the one you're going to get. Okay, and let me continue with the implementation, and you'll see how I do that magic. John, you had a question?
Yeah, just referring back to what Richard said about not templatizing the get by passing in a reference, I agree that it's nice if you use this, because one of the things you can do here is you could make it const, which you couldn't do the other one, right?
That's another point,
but,
yes.
But one of the things about, kind of a best practice thing is to not ever specify the types when calling templated functions. And one of the things that you might see here, for example, is that if you're going to specify the actual type, and, well, I guess I lost my train of thought. Sorry about
all we need is the ability to templatize on the return value, and we're good, right?
Yes.
And that was like, yes. Yeah. Yeah, where are we going to get that?
Well, you can't. The templated conversion operator. If you return a class that has a conversion operator that's templated, it'll convert to the return type, so you could kind of have overloading on return types.
So let me update our viewers. the comments basically are that John made the comment that with get being templated, you can also have const values, which is true, which you couldn't if you were passing in references. And then I think you made the comment that
we could return a class that
right.
stores a reference to kind of the way to get the data and then have a conversion.
Right. So you can also store a class that tells you how to get the data out of the class, and that's absolutely true. I actually, in the real code, I have a get with cast, okay, which does something similar, because sometimes I needed to do something like that, okay? And so there is a get with cast, and there's also a get with default, which I'm not showing here, okay? I mean, these are just details, okay? But absolutely, that's the beauty of Boost Any, is we can store anything we want that's copyable in the back end, including something that tells us how to unwrap itself, you know? Absolutely, we can do that. One of the problems I had with this framework was that I was imagining horrendously complicated back-end systems to do all sorts of clever things, and I quickly realized that's a bad idea, because I was getting too smart, you know. And it was good to keep it simple; otherwise, stuff becomes unreadable. Any other comments, questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you need the functionality of shared pointer in particular, or did that just kind of come over from when you were using Boost shared pointer? Just because from what I'm seeing here, it looks like unique pointer might be more appropriate.
Well, this was 2008, uh-huh. and unique pointer was a nice uh-huh. dream.
Yeah, like, is that something maybe you consider changing to now, or?
Yes, because in fact, CNE properties really are not copyable. They're singletons, and that would make a lot more sense, I think, today. I suppose there might be some sort of instance where you might want to copy it. Oh, excuse me, I forgot to repeat the question. The question was, I'm using shared pointer to store the bases, the handlers. Could I use unique pointer? And so I answered it already, I hope. But there might be an instance where you want to copy it, these guys. I never did, okay? But I could see where it's possibly desired. Okay. So let's look at the base class for the backend, okay? Now the backend is a lot simpler, right? This is, again, standard object-oriented C++ basic 101 stuff that anybody can do. Basically, we have the base class, we have the virtual destructor this time, okay? And we are going to have a get method, and the get method is going to return a boost any, okay? So now, again, one of the design requirements in this framework was that the ugliness is hidden in the back end, okay? And so boost any is hidden here in the back end, not in the front end, but here we're free to use it, okay? And I put implementations here for debugging, basically, which just throw in an exception. Because this is real code, you're going to see error catching and throwing and stuff like that. I'm not sure if that complicates things or simplifies things, but I thought I'd leave it in just because it's real, all right? Similarly, the set is going to take the key and a boost any value, okay? And it's going to do its thing in the back end. I then added a name, which is just a string, which I'm not going to show you at all. And I found that when you have 5 database instances and one of them has an error in the connection or something like that, it's nice to know which one it is that failed. So I added that name thing very quickly when I was using this in real life, okay? So that when an error occurs, it tells you which backend it was that failed, okay? And then here's the RTTI ugliness, okay? So thanks to Andre Alexandrescu, I used the Loki library. And the only thing, I really used exactly one thing from the Loki library. I used the type info wrapper. Okay, so type info in C++ is a little hard to deal with. In C++ 98 is a little hard to deal with. He wrote a very nice handler that lets you put them into containers and deal with them and copy them and do all this nice stuff, which you couldn't do. Obviously, in C++ 11, we can do this a lot more easily in more sophisticated ways. Question?
Yeah, were you needing to copy or move that type info vector app, or should that be returning?
I am copying that out. I'm sorry, I didn't tell you what that was. I was talking about Loki too much. But what this method is going to, and I didn't repeat the question. So the question was, am I going to copy that vector of type infos out? And the answer is yes, okay. I believed in the return value optimization, and I trusted my performance to it, and it didn't let me down. But as you're going to see, so what this vector is storing is it's storing the type infos for all the types that the backend supports. Remember, the backend doesn't support everything. The backend has a very specific list of types that it supports, and that vector is how the backend knows what it supports. And thus, when we build the backend, we're going to have to tell it what type we support, and we're going to tell it that by populating that vector. Okay, so we are returning the vector. Back in 2008, we were returning it by value, and we were copying it. But at most, I think the largest real backend I had 5 types in it. Okay, I found that going nuts and showing off by that, oh wow, I can use all these types, was just making things too complicated. So I didn't do that. Okay. Yes.
Yeah. So I was thinking about the performance. You're talking about the optimization that lets you return that, mm-hmm. to get it without the copy. You could also do the same thing on set if you were to take your value and set it as a const ref. Just take it as a value. You also have a performance like that.
Yes.
In situations where it was an R value.
So the question was that in addition to copying the vector here, I could have used I could have passed in the value by value instead of by const reference and taking advantage of optimizations. And you're absolutely right. Again, I'm going to rewrite this, and when I rewrite it for C++ 11, this will be by value because that's the way to go, obviously.
Yes, so.
And it doesn't require 11 to do that.
Right, that's right. So the comment was that it does not require C++ 11 to do that, and that is absolutely correct.
So what I did was actually, I used the template type, and then I created the Loki type value and populated the vector, except I used the set so that I didn't get duplicates. Mm-hmm. So effectively, I'm doing exactly the same thing you're doing, except that I'm doing it on the sets, because after all, you're only going to encounter those values that you want to put in, if you will. But then I did a boost any inside of the set, right? Because then I wanted to cast the actual value, the template value, whether it was an int or a double or a string, mm-hmm. or whatever, when I did the set.
So the comment was, tell me if I got this straight,
right.
Please. The comment was that you used a set instead of a vector here to, one, avoid duplicate values. Is that right?
Right, because I didn't know which one's a priori. I was unwilling to define them. Mm-hmm. I wanted them to be derived naturally from the set of values that I was setting into
right.
the...
Right. So the comment was that you didn't want to specify the types a priori, whereas I am, and I did want to specify the types a priori. So we had different requirements here, and thus the different implementation. Yeah.
You can achieve the same thing with a vector if you apply unique on the vector.
You mean the algorithm?
Yes.
So Jens is saying that. That you can achieve the same thing by calling a unique on the vector, and then it's added as long as it's sorted. But if you look at how we implement the backend, in fact, you're just specifying manually the list of types that you're going to do, you're going to add. It's not dynamic in any way. It's completely static.
This is over-engineering to have a set for in this compile
yeah.
type.
Yeah.
Or optimization, because that's only called during startup of the whole engine.
Yes. So the comment was that it's over-engineering to store a set or to unicify, if that's a word, the vector. I would agree. Most handlers had one type in them. The next bunch had two. You know, in reality, things didn't return that many types. Okay, I actually didn't find uses for returning complicated types all that often. A couple times, but even then, and one of the database handlers that did create a very complicated type, that was the only thing it did. So, there was no point. I could have mixed it with other database handlers that return simple types. So that was one of the dilemmas. Where do I split up the backends? Okay, I could have had one database backend and passed it the key as a SQL query, for example. But that just was not as useful, in my opinion. So, yeah.
For
for your requirements, it might be an interesting thought experiment if you replace a vector by an initializer list.
Yes, absolutely. For C++ 11.
Yes.
Yes. So the comment was that it would be interesting to replace this vector here with a initializer list, and I agree wholeheartedly because I had to write a cute little helper function to make this work. It's cute, but and it's not very difficult. But today in C++ 11, it's part of the language, and we don't have to do this stuff. I wouldn't need to use Loki anymore, and things would be a lot cleaner. So agreed. Any other comments? All right, so that's the back end, basically. Let's look at the guts and see where the magic actually happens. Oh, I'm sorry. This is the guts. All right. This is the first cut, so we're looking at the top of the guts. So because get and set were parameterized, were templatized, I had to expose their implementation in the header file, okay? But what I did was basically I called the private get and the private set, and the x underscore was our notation for a private method, okay? And that's all it did, it forwarded the call to the private get any and the private set any classes, but with two small differences. Now, as you see, I am going to pass in the type ID of the type forget, okay, because I do need it in the backend. I just wanted to hide that from the client, okay? And then the other thing is that we're returning a boost any because this is eventually going to come from the backend, and as you recall, the backend interface returned a boost any, okay? So, but you can see now how the magic works, okay? So the x get any is going to return a boost any. We're going to boost any cast it back to t, and the client gets his t back and is happy and has no idea the trials that his poor data underwent on the way to get to him, okay? He just got his data. That's all that matters at the end, all right? So the setter is even simpler, okay? We don't have to specify the type because we're passing in the value and the value has a type associated with it, all right? So this is very straightforward. This is the heart of the talk, okay? And this is a little complicated, so we'll spend some time going over it, but don't fear, about half of this code is error handling, okay? So, hang on, I did not finish talking about the front end, so there's a missing piece here. Excuse me. So, I forgot to mention, and that comes to your comment, In the private part here, we have the handler map and for gets and for sets. Okay, and the handler map is mapping the key, its key is the type ID. All right, and the value is a vector of handlers. Okay, so when we register a type, all right, we're going to place in when we call add get handler, okay, we're going to register all of the types that handler handles in this map. So we're going to have an entry in this map for those types, and we're going to push back the actual handler into the vector that handles those types, okay? So this is how we're going to manage those multiple handlers for the various types, okay? Similarly, for the set handlers, we're going to map the types to the set handler, and we only have one, so we don't need a vector anymore. Okay, question.
So then, I think this is interesting. So you allow a single key to have multiple instances depending on its type.
Yeah.
So I could have my date be considered as a number, an epoch time, or actually a string.
Yes. So the question was this design allows you to have the same key reference different types, and that's absolutely true. That was actually by design for crazy reasons, okay, but that was one of the requirements we had. And so, yes, so...
It sounds complicated.
It is, but it's seamless to the client again. And so when you get the date, all you have to do is specify the type. So the example that was given was that a date can be in a string, it can be an epoch time, or it can be a number, okay? And that's absolutely true. And you would tell the the client would tell the system which one he wants to get by specifying the template, the type when he calls get.
But that's horrid. I mean, if I had a but if I had a property that was, I don't know, like costs, and it was in doubles, but then later on some other client was like, oh, I just want to take a look at the cost in raw dollars, I'll just get it by int.
Mm-hmm.
That could be a completely different property. It is, because even though they are convertible to each other, it could be the case he reads in and it's like, oh, that hasn't actually been set yet, or it could have been set to an older value. That sounds...
You are right. So the comment was that is potentially bad, because you may expect a property to be one type, but then in fact somebody else may put in the same property key with a different type, and somebody may get the wrong type, basically. And the example was given was a cost in dollars, which could be either a float or an int. And you're in fact storing it in floats, but somebody else gets an int and gets the wrong thing. And that is true. We, like I said, we actually had a reason to do this, a bad reason, unfortunately.
Okay, but you had a reason.
Yeah, and we had to do this. Now, one thing I do want to point out, that in that situation, remember, you have control of the order that the get handlers are queried, okay? So if ultimately, it's the client's responsibility to know which type he wants to get. And so if he's wrong, he's wrong. But you're right. Potentially, we could limit keys to one value. I'm not sure how we could enforce that short of storing all the keys in a set, say, and checking that. But
so the back end could get the key, determine if it is convertible to that type.
But the back end will never see a key if it's the wrong type. Okay, because the backend knows which types it handles, and so the backend will only get queries for the types it can handle.
Well, I will make the backend so he doesn't know about the types he handles. Just like, hey, you don't care about your types; you just handle keys.
Right,
and you tell me if it's convertible.
And that's more what you're talking about, right?
Because when I did this, the first thing that happened was is that I would get booze any cast with throw exception, throw illegal any cast exception.
Right.
And according in your code, that's what happened.
Right.
You
okay.
You actually did a get, and you were asking for an int, and there was a string. You would get an anycast exception.
That is
and
correct.
And it would be thrown past the get out. So what I did was I used a bool. I said bool get constant string ampersand key, comma, then t colon value, so that I was always returning the value, so I was able to get the get always knew what value it was getting, because it could derive the get the value or the template parameter from the second argument. And then if it didn't work, I returned false if it wasn't that type, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And I just handled the try catch,
right,
and the exception inside the get.
So the comment was that the boost any cast, so let's go look at where it's actually being done, and that's here, right? So that the boost any cast right there will throw an exception if you have the wrong type, right? So if you stored a string into the boost any and you're calling get with an int, it will throw an exception. You're absolutely correct. I'm not showing it here, but I had several gets, okay? So this was the risky live on the edge get, okay, which could throw a boost any exception. I had another get with default, okay, which would put this in a try catch, okay, and then if the exception was thrown, it returned the default value, okay, and then there was the safe get as well, okay?
I actually have three too.
Right, so I'm not showing you all these. Those, again, are just details, but they are, I believe they are in the code. I hope I didn't delete them when I upgraded it.
Yeah, and I believe this is even safe, because the get any gets passed in the type T as a type ID, so it only looks up in backends that actually support that type, so you can assume that only this returns, and then the cast is okay.
That is correct. So the comment was that, in fact, I am passing in the value in get. The get in the guts knows what type it's looking for. And only handlers that can handle that type would respond to this query. Now, what that means is when you had a boost any exception thrown, it means you either forgot to add the type you're looking for into the list in the back end, or you made some sort of mistake. It's like an assertion, basically. So that's absolutely correct. In real life, that exception should not get thrown. Okay, there was another, yeah.
Had you considered an interface using boost optional instead of throwing exceptions?
No. So the question was, have I considered using an interface with boost optional instead of throwing exceptions? And the answer was no, because when I wrote this, I had no idea what boost optional was. So.
Would you change it to that now?
So the question is, would I change it to that now if I could? I don't know. I'd have to think about. I'm hardly familiar with boost optional except to know that it exists. So I need to read about it. And if you have suggestions, please let me know. I'll be glad to know, because I just don't know at this point. Okay. So let's continue. Yeah, let's go to the big slide. All right. So, how does this work? Here is the actual guts of where, like I say, the rubber meets the road. Okay, the object-oriented and the generic are going to come together. All right? And so this is our xGetAny, our private getAny, which takes, in addition to the key, takes the type that we're looking for. So the first thing we do is make sure that there's a good key here. Okay? Then we go to our map, our handler map, our get handler map, okay, which is mapping type IDs to a vector of handlers. All right, so every type ID has a vector of handlers that can handle that specific type ID, and we're going to look for that. We're going to look for that particular value that we have, right? So get in the guts, get knows what type it's looking for, and if we don't find a handler for that type, we're going to throw an exception. Okay, so we either have a handler for the type or we throw an exception. All right, so if we get past this point, we know that there's a handler for this type. Unless we made a mistake in coding things, there should be a response. Or of course, it's possible that the handler doesn't have a key in its in its knowledge, but that's not an error that we're going to throw here. Okay, so we now have the vector of handlers here that we're going to put into this handler list over here, and then we're going to walk the elements of the vector, which are handler pointers, okay, with the for each if, and we're going to walk them one at a time, and we're going to use this cQuery handler functor, which I'm going to show you in a second, which is going to actually take the key, query the particular handler that was passed to it by the for each if, and get a value back. Now, what is for each if? It is not a standard algorithm. I don't think it is now, but it was certainly not when I wrote this. It's a modification of for each that takes a predicate, and when the predicate is satisfied, so for each takes a functor that can be anything, but this one requires a predicate. When the predicate returns true, the iteration stops. So it's for each until maybe would be a better name. So the question was, isn't that find or find if? There is one big difference between find if and for each, and for each if, and the difference is that for each if returns the functor that was in there, and for each, of course, is the only standard algorithm. Maybe that's not true anymore, but it is was the one of the standard algorithms that you can actually put state into your functor and depend on it, because you were guaranteed that you would be called once per iteration. Okay.
A general technique for putting state into your functor is to, when you pass it in, wrap it in std ref or boost ref. Then it gets passed as a reference instead of as by value, and it won't get copied.
So the comment was that instead of doing it this way, you can pass in a functor with std ref. Now it's std ref. Then it was boost ref, and thus you won't make any copies, and thus you can use the regular libraries, and I didn't know that at the time. So there you go, the education of a C++ programmer. Yeah, in C++ 11, this is so much easier. It's shocking how much easier it is. But so for each if is like for each is going to actually return the functor, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to store the value in the functor. And so once I get the functor back from for each if, okay, first of all I'm going to get the value that was stored in it. If there is no value, that means I didn't find one, okay? And I'm going to throw that exception that the key was not found, all right? I also catch that exception in my default get with default, okay? But otherwise, I'm just going to get that value out of the functor into a boost, put into a boost any, and return it, okay? So the functor is constructed with the key, is passed to handlers one by one in the order of the vector that they're storing in the vector, queries each handler for that key. If the query is successful, it gets the value in the functor's internal memory. The functor is passed back out of for each if, and for each if stops when the functor, the predicate, returns true because it found the value. We then get it back here and we use the value and return it to the client. This is the heart of the rubber meeting the road here, right here, is where it's all being done. Okay? This shows, this process here shows one of the limitations of this code, all right? Anybody see it? This code has a problem, and this was a real problem, in fact, that there is no way to distinguish a key pointing to an empty value from the key not being present. Okay, so I'm relying on an empty boost handler to show me that the key was not present. So there's no way to return an empty class. Now what I did was I actually created a struct that was C nothing or C empty class. I forget what I called it, okay? And potentially you could use that to represent an empty class, but that was a big pain in reality, okay? Because now the handlers had to deal with all that and pass that class when they were empty, and you had to make a special check. In reality, that wasn't a big obstacle for me, okay? The only place where that really was a problem was in the environment, where I couldn't distinguish between the key being present and having no string and the key not being present at all. And again, that to me, that didn't turn out to be a problem, but you would have to work, you can work around this, okay? Was there a question? All right, has this been digested? I'm gonna move on. Like I said, this is the heart of the matter. It's all downhill from here. I'm just going to show you the for each if. This is very straightforward. I took for each and I added an if statement there. Very difficult, okay? This is the query handler functor, okay? It's got the old-fashioned way to say that I'm a predicate, and what it does, it takes the key, it stores it, it has a place to store the value, it gets the handler pointer in its function call operator, and it essentially calls get into the backend interface. Remember, we had that object-oriented backend. We're getting a pointer to one of those concrete classes, and we're calling get on it. The backend knows how to get its data, returns in a boost any. If it has one, puts it into m value, and then if this is not empty, we return it, and so we're returning true. The value is stored in here. We got the functor back. Again, this is how it works, okay? I'll quickly show you the setter, but the setter is actually simpler because one, we know the value, we know the type, and two, we only have to deal with one handler basically. So we have a value which is now in the boost any. Again, we check for an empty key and we throw. We grab the value because remember I didn't pass the value explicitly when I was calling the setter. So we actually get the value. We look it up in the map just like before. We hopefully, if we don't find a handler, we throw an exception. Hey, you need to have a handler for this type, okay? And if we have a handler, we get the pointer right there, and we call set, okay, passing in the key and the value, okay? And of course, the value is in boost any at this point. Okay, this is, I hope, straightforward and simpler than the get. That surprised me, by the way. When I started this, I expected get to be easier than set. I was wrong. here is the registration magic for the handlers. Okay, so when we're adding a new get handler, okay, we are going to get the types. So remember the handler had the get handle types, which was a vector of all the type IDs for the type that it supported. Okay, we're going to get that vector and copy it here. Okay, and we're going to walk through. Here's my C++ 11. Apologies. Obviously, it's not trivial to change this back to 98. We're going to walk through those types one by one, and we're going to add them to the map. Okay, so. We are going to get the vector for that particular map. If it doesn't exist, right, operator bracket will create the entry for us. I love operator bracket sometimes. Other times I hate it. But this is one of the places where I love it. Okay, so we get that handler, and then we push back the handler into the list. And so, of course, it's done in the order the client calls them. And so we can specify an order, which is, again, why I wanted the vector there. The set handler is much simpler. We just basically put in the map. All right. Again.
Apparently, it does need to be capitalized. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Oh yes.
But apparently, it does need to be capitalized.
Right. And there is the reason. Oh, thank God. Okay. So, I'm not crazy. So this refers to John's question from about.
That was Richard.
Oh, okay. Excuse me. From about a half an hour ago as to why set handler was templatized, and here's the reason right there, because we need to know its type. Okay?
But doesn't the handler pointer handle a bunch of different types?
No. The handler point, so the question was, doesn't the, you're talking about the set handler?
Yeah, like I thought the handler is the back end, and you
right.
have many different types for a particular query.
Yes.
So I'm saying this is more of a for all ints, use this type handler.
Yes. So the question was, does this, I'm not sure what the question was.
It was a comment,
yeah.
Does that mean that if I wanted to have handlers, the handler is my back end, and you say I have environment, database, and whatever else.
Yeah.
But if I wanted to fall back, and I was like, okay, I want you to look for ints in my database, and if it's not there, look for ints in the...
So we're talking about get handlers, not set handlers.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
So the question was basically why we... how to explain that?
Don't worry about it.
The question was that how are we dealing with multiple different types, and the answer was that get handlers have a list of types that they can handle, and not just one. Okay? Was there yes?
Well, one comment in that case, it would make sense to ask the handler whether it handles this type T.
So the question was, does it make sense to allow the handler to report whether it handles type T?
It has even the method that it got it.
Yeah. I actually did implement that, and I took it out because it was too much information for the client, and it was leading to bad practices by the clients, basically. But absolutely, you could do that if you trusted your clients. I mean, think about why would you want that information, and what would you do with it if you had it?
No, it was just meant as a check, because, well, you can ask the handler pointer anyhow for the handle types. And I assume it's symmetric, that the same types you can get, you can also set in that handler. And then you can just loop over whether the type T is in the list of supported types for that handler. And if not, tell the client this one for.
But you wouldn't have, okay, so the, I'm not sure I understood that exactly.
Then we can take it offline.
Oh, okay, well, we'll talk about this later. So, you've seen this before. This is the back end base class. What I want to do in the last few minutes is show you a couple of back ends, basically. And remember, the ugliness is here, okay? So cover your eyes if you're sensitive, all right? This is the base class. I won't go over it again. Here's the most trivial handler that I had, and it actually turned out to be useful. Basically, we store everything in a map, and we handle exactly one type, which is passed into, which is on which this is parameterized. So we're storing everything in a map. Okay. So this is useless in the beginning. It's empty. All right. But you can call set on it, and then you can get that data out again. All right. But what this does do is it shows us how a basic handler works. Okay, so we're basically storing the data in the map. Okay, get is going to look up the value in the map. All right, right there. And if it's not in there, we're just going to return an empty value. Otherwise, we are going to put in the value that we found in the map into the boost any and return it. Okay, so if the value is found, we return it. If the value is not found, we return an empty, a null constructed value. And remember, the functor is going to query that boost any value for it, whether it's empty. If it's empty, then it's assumed the key was not found. All right. Set is even simpler as usual. We just put it into the map. Okay. And then here's how get handle type works. I wrote this helper function, which I'm not going to show you, which basically takes all of its template arguments and pushes them back into a vector of type IDs. Okay. This is C++ 98, so there's a limit on how many you can do. In C++ 11, I'd use a variadic template, and this would be much easier. Okay. And this is actually a functor, as you can see. So anyway, it creates the vector and it returns it. All right. So at this point, we only have one type that we're handling. So let's look at a real handler. Now, this was an actual production handler that I modified because we used our framework to access the environment. And if I used that in this code here, you would have to bring in the whole framework to exercise the code, and I didn't want that. So I just replaced it with the C library calls. All right, so basically we have a key. We are going to call getenv on the key and get a value, which will be a C string, which I'm then going to convert into an std string and put into the value if it's there and return it. Again, if the key is not there, then we get a null pointer right there. We don't put anything in the value. We return an empty value. Set is similar. It hides the ugliness that you have to put together a C string with the key equals value that putinv requires right there. And we check that putinv succeeded. And we throw an exception if it didn't. It's a big ugly exception. This is not real C++. This is slide C++. Okay. And then the only thing we support here for an environment is std string. Okay, so this is very simple. I'm just going to go through these a couple handlers very quickly. There's no rocket science here. This is one I wrote for this for this talk. We didn't know about JSON back in 2008 at where I was working, but I put together this handler to show a little more complex system. So we got first name, last name, which are strings. We have the age, which is an int. We have address field, which is actually a map of strings to strings. And we have phone numbers, which I'm going to store as a vector of structs, okay? And the struct is going to contain a string, actually two strings, okay? I'm not going to show you the dirty details. It doesn't really matter. The whole, and really this is pointless, but the whole point here is to show a backend handler that handles multiple types, okay? And this is going to get ugly. So the first thing you need to realize is that you can't throw just any JSON at this, okay? You have to throw JSON that has these values in it. Now, you can have default values in the back end if they're not present, if say first name is not present, or you can, and obviously we could put additional values in here as well, and they just would never get queried and returned into types, okay? But now there are certainly ways you can clean this up, but what I really wanted to just show you here is how we handle multiple types and how ugly things get very quickly when we start to want to handle multiple types. And that's why in real life I actually kept my handlers simple. So this is going to be very abbreviated, but you can see this code on GitHub, okay, if you want to see the full ugliness. But basically what I'm doing is I'm going to store std map of the keys to boost any values, okay? And the boost any values are going to be all the different types I'm storing in the JSON. Now, before I go on, one quick apology. This code requires JSON Spirit to compile, and I did not provide a makefile in my code. So you're going to need JSON Spirit to compile this. You're going to have to say -i to JSON Spirit to get this to work, and my apologies for that. But what we have is basically the constructor for the handler is going to take a JSON file name, and remember, it is the client that instantiates the handlers, okay? So the client knows where the data is supposed to come from, okay? So it's going to pass the JSON file name, and then JSON spirit is going to parse the JSON, and I'm not showing you how we build all that stuff, but basically it's going to pull out the values, and look, we have to specifically pass in the types that we want to get into these things, okay? So like I said, there's ugliness here, okay? You could make this more dynamic by testing for types and do all sorts of complicated things in the back end. There is, as far as I know, there's no way to get rid of the ugliness here. The ugliness is going to be here. The whole point is, though, that the ugliness is hidden under the rug, right, behind the bed, so that the client can't see it. Once that ugliness is done, the client can get this data, and so we have the string stored in m values of first name in the map, the string for the last name, the int for the age, I guess that should be unsigned, and then the map of the addresses is put into there, and then the vector of structs. Again, I just wanted to show you a dynamic example, an example that handles multiple types. Okay, I'm not going to show you the rest. It's boilerplate. And then the last thing I wanted to show is a real life backend that is truly ugly. I'm not going to show you the implementation. This is not in the code base, but this is actual production code that is in the public domain. Okay, and it handles a database connection. So we have private methods which do all this exciting stuff, construct SQL query, connect to database name, password, all this stuff. We have this, oh my God, auto pointer of the M connection.
Wow, that's very good, dirty laundry.
I'm dating myself. Yes. I was forced to use an auto pointer by the database interface that I was talking to, because I certainly would use a shared pointer had I had a choice, or maybe I don't remember the details, but there was a reason I had to use auto pointer. Anyway, this is a mess, okay? But again, the backend just had the key value interface, and obviously, database is more powerful than the key value interface, but that's how we used it. In fact, this particular database, all it did was return an int. So believe it or not, but
all it did was return ints. Is that what you
an int? Yes, it was basically based on a very complicated configuration system, and the int was telling us which build of the genome we needed to get. So I put a couple of additional applications for type erasure. If you'll notice, these really aren't additional applications. They're exactly the same thing. A heterogeneous factory function would be, a heterogeneous factory class would be one that, right, creates classes and returns them based on some sort of resource or key. And of course, that's exactly what we're doing here, basically. And the registry is the same thing. We use registries in my current distributed computation system. And where we want data to be transferred between machines, so of course we store it in the registry, then the key fetches that data. We're going to be also doing that with executable code using C++11, that we can do that now. And so presumably, I think, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't see why you can store a lambda or some sort of boost function in this code and do fancy things with it. So the real thing, though, is that I wasn't able to come up with additional applications. Maybe you guys can come up with additional applications, but I think the main takeaway is that type erasure is not the magic bullet that I was hoping it was going to be. It doesn't make C++ into Python and give us the fun of Python. I admit I like Python is fun in a way C++ isn't, but then I get real work done with C++. And somebody always will have to know what type we want to get out of the data, out of the boost any, and in order to do something. What type erasure really does is it gives you the chance to expose clean interfaces and hide your dirty laundry in the back end where nobody can see it, where the clients can't see it, they don't have to worry about it. And I think the main takeaway is that type erasure's best thing to do is to glue object-oriented and generic code. I hope I showed that to you today. And I'm almost done. I just wanted to thank Mike DiCuccio, who let me write that in the government, and to use Boost. We weren't allowed to use Boost, but Boost Any is a standalone header, and I just used Boost Any, and that I was allowed to do that. To give them credit, we later brought Boost in bits, but progress was made. Andrei Alexandrescu, of course, wrote Loki. Kevlin Henney, as far as I know, is the guy who wrote Boost Any. Scott Myers, who pointed me in the right direction to get it started, and poor Edvard Munch, whose painting I mangled for my own purposes. Thank God that copyrights expire. So that is it. Thank you very much, and I'll take questions.